Immediately following our next special, we'll have Pastor Wayne Maynard to speak to us concerning Arise for Success. Pastor Maynard serves at the Shiloh Baptist Church on Nevis.
Quiet place with you, I bow before your throne. I bring the deepest part of me to you and you alone. I keep no secrets, for there is no thought you have not known. I bring my past and all the rest to you and lay them down. Ooh. With all my heart, I want to love you, Lord, and live my life each day to know you more. All that is in me is yours completely. I'll serve you only with all my heart. You faithfully supply my needs according to your plan. So help me, Lord, to seek your face before I seek your hand. And trust you know what's best for me when I don't understand. To follow in obedience in every circumstance. With all my heart, I want to love you, Lord, and live my life each day to know you.
That's the only way to truly serve the Lord. Amen. And to love him with all that is within us. And he deserves nothing less. Thank God for his love towards us, and that we can respond to that love with such gratitude that we'll give our very lives for his honor and for his glory. Today I'll be preaching from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 2, Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 down to verse number 20, Nehemiah chapter 2 and verse number 1. And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him, And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been beforetime sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, Why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, Let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad, when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, For what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said unto the king, If it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchres, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by him, For how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Moreover, I said unto the king, If it please the king, let letters be given me to the governors beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come into Judah, and a letter unto Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the palace, which appertain to the house, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me according to the good hand of my God upon me. Then I came to the governors beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. So I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. And I arose in the night, I and some few men with me. Neither told I any man what God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. And I went out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire. Then I went on to the gate of the fountain, and to the king's pool, but there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. Then went I up in the night by the brook, and viewed the wall, and turned back, and entered by the gate of the valley, and so returned. And the rulers knew not whither I went, or what I did. Neither had I as yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work. Then said I unto them, Ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's words that he had spoken unto me. And they said, Let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arabian heard it, they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, What is this thing that ye do? Will ye rebel against the king? Then answered I them and said unto them, The God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore, we are his servants, and we will arise and build. But ye have no portion, nor right, nor memorial in Jerusalem. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your precious word. We thank you for your mercy, your grace upon our lives. We thank you for the privilege we have to serve you, to worship you, to give our very lives for your honor and for your glory. Dear Lord, I pray today as your word goes forth that you would give me the words you'll have me to say for this occasion. I pray that you would take full control. May Holy Spirit work in each and every heart and life. And I pray, dear Lord, that when it's all said and done, that you will be well pleased. I pray that you would save some lost soul. And for every believer, each heart would be challenged, motivated, and stirred to be closer drawn to you. Do what only you can do. Have your divine way. And we'll be careful to praise you and give you all the honor and glory that's due your holy name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you so much for standing. You may be seated. Alexander Dostoevsky, a U.S. aviator and engineer, was once visiting a fellow flyer in the hospital. The young man had just lost his leg. Dostoevsky, who had an artificial leg for some time, tried to cheer him up. "The loss of a leg is not so great a calamity," he said. "If you get hit on a wooden leg, it doesn't hurt a bit. Try it." The patient raised his walking stick and brought it down hard on the Dostoevsky's leg. "You see," he said cheerfully, "if you hit an ordinary man like that, he'd be in bed for 5 days. With that, the Dostoevsky left his friend and limped into the corridor where he collapsed in excruciating pain. You see, it seems the young man had struck the Dostoevsky on his good leg. You see, my friends, good intentions are not a guarantee for success. As a matter of fact, good intentions combined with inappropriate actions will ultimately lead to failure. The theme for this West Indies Baptist Fellowship Conference, Arise and Rebuild, is a call to action, a call to reconstruct what previously existed, a call to get some things done that either are not being done or not being done with the required sense of urgency or level of participation by those who should be involved in the rebuilding. The recognition is that there are some things that are broken down. They're not the way they used to be. They're not the way they are supposed to be. Spiritually speaking, I will submit to all of us here today that the world is in a bad place. Or families, or churches, or schools, or communities, or nations are in a state of spiritual disrepair. Morals, the sense of right and wrong, love for God, love for people, standards of living, and human decency have been broken down. It has left many exposed to the devastating elements of sinfulness. Children in homes with no direction, marriages struggling to survive, schools that previously provided safety and helpful guidance for wholesome living are now in an environment where children's lives are being destroyed as they're openly exposed to drugs, alcohol, sex, atheism, and distorted ideology. Walls, my friends, have been broken down. And as a result, we are in trouble. The enemy is having a field day. But like those few Jews said in the book of Nehemiah, I submit to us today that it is time for those of us who know the truth, those of us who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, who are part of his local organism, the church. It is a program for furthering his kingdom on earth. My friend, it is time for us to arise and rebuild. But we must recognize that this call to action must be so much more than a good intention. You see, it is very natural. It is very easy. In fact, it is logical to conclude that whenever someone has an intention to rebuild, to accomplish any endeavor for that matter, that their desire is the successful completion of that effort. Why start if the intent is to fail? But clearly, with these wonderful intentions that we have, success is not always the result. With this existing reality in mind, as I pondered my topic, Arise for Success, it was evident that in arising for success as the intended outcome, there are some attitudes, some agendas, some actions that must be in alignment if success is going to take place. I'm normally the individual who would give people the benefit of the doubt. And I'm willing today to give the benefit of the doubt that if an individual is going to rise and arise with the intention for success, that the desire and the goal is to have success. However, the idea is to arise for success to be the result and not just the intention. Are you hearing me today? If we're going to arise for success, it must be that we are arising for success to be the end result. Because it's very easy for success to be not much more than the intention. The book of Nehemiah is a great book to examine the blueprint for success in rebuilding. We understand that in the context of Nehemiah, the children of Israel were facing a major rebuilding challenge. The walls of Jerusalem had been broken down. But as we read the entirety of this book and as we understand this story, we understand that under the leadership of Nehemiah, they arose for success and they had success. Amen? So the question is, what components, what characteristics were evident in the lives of Nehemiah and these Jews that brought about this success? What attitudes did they have? What actions did they engage in? I'm so glad that you asked me here today, because I want us to examine and to extract as best as we can the principles that they applied to have success. I'm going to admit to you here today that I want success. I want to have success. And I believe that we want to have success. But success is not a destination. Success is a journey. What do I mean by that? I simply mean that we cannot afford to just want success today. We cannot just want to have success tomorrow. But we need success today, tomorrow, the next day, the next week, next month, next year, and the years to come. How do we arise for that kind of success? Well, I want you to notice with me, first of all, if we observe Nehemiah in chapter 2, we must, first of all, discern the badness. We must discern the badness. Notice with me that Nehemiah, first of all, had an interest in what was taking place. Nehemiah was very grieved. The Bible says in verse number 1, and it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him, and he said, I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Nehemiah was sad because even though he was doing well, even though he was in a palace, make no mistake about it, Nehemiah was in a very comfortable place. He was eating well. He was living well. But his interest was with the condition of his people and his homeland. He had an interest. And because of his interest, he sought to inquire what was going on. Nehemiah asked some questions. And these questions were not in an effort to, as we would say colloquially, to look news. It was because of his heart of concern about what was going on. Nehemiah took this a step further and investigated to see for himself. If you look back at chapter 1, you would notice that the Bible says, "Then Hananiah, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked concerning them, the Jews, that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire." Nehemiah inquired. Nehemiah said, "I need to know what's happening. Even though I'm in a very comfortable place, my heart is with the condition of my people. My heart is with the condition of Jerusalem." He was interested. He inquired. And in chapter 2, we recognize that he wanted to investigate. He wanted to see for himself. He had heard the news, but he wanted to observe with his own eyes the state of his beloved city of Jerusalem. And I say to us, as we look around at our world, at our homes, at our communities, at our nations, and at our world, don't take my word for it. Let's look around. Let's see what's happening. Homes are in trouble. Marriages are suffering and struggling. 50% of all marriages end in divorce. That statistic does not change among born-again believers and professing Christians. Schools, children are dropping out. There's disrespect that's rampant. Drugs and sex and godlessness. I mean, we have churches with religious activity, with little personal relationship with God. Empty routine, a lack of passion and excitement for the things of God. There are more churches than ever before, but it seems like there is less love for God. My friends, we are in trouble. Many churches are struggling to keep the doors open. There's a missing generation of people with interest to carry on the work of God. Governments are pouring millions of dollars into social programs without transformation because the heart of man is not addressed. We must be willing to discern the badness. It is not a pretty picture. Nehemiah decided he could not just stay in the palace. He could not just enjoy the good life. He had to go and see for himself the state of Jerusalem, the state of his people. And because Nehemiah was willing to discern the badness, notice with me secondly, he acquired a distinct burden. His eyes affected his heart. Notice with me back in chapter 1 and verse number 4. The Bible says, "And it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept." and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Nehemiah had deep, heartfelt concern for the situation. Have you ever observed the devastation of our world and shed a tear? Can you say in your heart of hearts that you are genuinely concerned? My friend, I ask this question because this is where change begins. It begins with a heartfelt concern. The heart has to be touched by the societal decay. And if you're not truly concerned, you must proceed to ask the question, why? Because you see, my friends, just because we're not concerned at the level we ought to be does not mean that we're not affected. You see, God, in creating these wonderful bodies that we have, that the psalmist says are so fearfully and wonderfully made, God has given us nerves. And he's given us these nerves as part of a nervous system to allow us to feel. Why is this so important? Because being able to feel allows us to protect ourselves. Can you imagine what it would be like if you couldn't sense heat? You couldn't sense danger? But because we are able to sense and detect harm, we're able to then respond in a way to protect ourselves. My friend, it is so vitally important that we are able to sense the danger in our world, this danger in our communities, and to be touched and to be moved by it. Nehemiah, as a result of his observation, had a distinct burden. He was concerned for the situation. And then notice with me his cry to the sovereign. In chapter 1 and verse number 4, the Bible says, he prayed before the God of heaven. Nehemiah says, this concern, this burden is more that can be resolved on my own. And he prayed to God, but I find his prayer very instructive. Because rather than pray and simply ask God to fix the situation, notice some aspects that are very important regarding Nehemiah's prayer. He began his prayer to God with confession. He says in verse number 5, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Look at his request. Let thine ear now be attentive and thy eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night, for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. Now imagine, Nehemiah is praying to the God of heaven, and the very first thing that he recognizes that must be addressed is the fact that collectively they had failed God. He cried to the sovereign. He said, God, we have sinned. And oftentimes, our response to the badness, our response to the decay, our response to the depravity is to cry out to God for help. But my friend, we first must of all understand the root of the problem is sin. And Nehemiah cries to the sovereign and he says, God, confession must be the first priority in crying to you. But notice he followed up this confession with intercession. verse number 11, for the sake of time, we don't have time to read all the verses, but he says in verse 11, O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name. And prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Nehemiah says, now that I've confessed, I can intercede. It was a prayer of intercession. And oftentimes we want to intercede without addressing the issue of sin. But Nehemiah understood what was needed to get the attention of God. He cried to the sovereign. But notice with me that Nehemiah, in this distinct burden that he had acquired, I love this, he communicated with sincerity. In chapter 2, we understand that the king observes his countenance, seeing that Nehemiah is sad. And Nehemiah was not afraid or ashamed to share his burden, to share his concern. Nehemiah was asked by the king, Nehemiah, why are you sad? And Nehemiah was initially afraid. And we can understand why that would have been the case. But Nehemiah understood that my concern and my fear for my well-being pales in comparison for my concern for my people. You see, Nehemiah could have figured that the king would be upset and mad as a result of him sharing his concern. You say, why is that? Well, the king was the ruler of the kingdom where Nehemiah's people were in captivity. So in effect, the king was a part of the problem. But Nehemiah communicated with sincerity, even though he was afraid. One of the biggest and common quote-unquote lies told in church is, I'm fine. We chuckle because we know it's true. Am I right? How are you doing today? I'm fine. Do you have a problem with me? No. It's often so difficult for us to admit we have a problem. And hence, sadly, at times we carry on these burdens and we carry them around continually. But Nehemiah had a burden and he said what the problem was. You see, oftentimes we don't communicate the problem because if we were to admit honestly, we are more concerned with our personal well-being than the being of the entire body, if there truly is a problem. Remember Esther? Remember Esther when her people were at risk of being annihilated? And Esther, who was hesitant, was told by Mordecai, listen, you have a responsibility. Not just to yourself, but to your entire nation. And Esther mustered up the courage to be able to simply say, listen, if I perish, I perish. Why? She understood there was so much at stake. Nehemiah had a distinct burden. And because of his distinct burden, he communicated with sincerity. But notice what else he did. He was able to convince some servants. We read the text, and so for the sake of time, I won't read all these verses, but notice in verse number 12, the Bible says, and I arose in the night, I and some few men with me. He took some servants with him. He took some individuals who could see the situation for themselves. Look at verse 17. He says, then I said unto them, ye see the distress that we are in? How Jerusalem lieth waste? And the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come, let us build up the wall of Jerusalem that we be no more a reproach. You see, my friends, the problems that we are talking about and the problems that we are experiencing with broken walls will not be resolved by one person. It will require a collaborative effort. Nehemiah had a burden that he had to share. And so he took people with him to see the walls in a state of disrepair. Has God given you a burden? Share that burden with others. Communicate to help others connect the dots. And if you have a distinct burden for the things of God, you would recognize that oftentimes everybody does not share that burden. But that's okay. Everybody doesn't get it at the same time either. And you don't always have to explain in great detail. Why? Because if you were honest, you didn't even get that burden overnight. God worked in your heart. And God brought you to this place to see things that He would have you to see. But here's what people ought to see. Even if they don't understand your burden, they ought to see your burden. They ought to see the concern. Nehemiah had a distinct burden. And you see, my friends, if we're going to arise for success, it must be precipitated by a burden that God uses to fuel our hearts to do what He's called us to do. It comes from having a distinct burden. But notice, thirdly, because of this distinct burden, there was very importantly a decision to build. A decision to build. Notice the decisive action in verse number 7. Moreover, I said to the king, if it please the king, let letters be given to me to the governors beyond the river, that I may convey me over till I come into Judah. Verse number 9, 8 and 9 chronicles the fact that Nehemiah simply got busy. You see, my friends, when God gives a burden, we must act on it. Great changes and movements throughout history have often begun with one person. This was a monumental effort. Nehemiah understood that. But he also understood that if I don't act based on this burden that God has placed in my heart, nothing will get done. He responded with decisive action. And mark it down. Whenever you respond with decisive action to do what God has laid on your heart to do, mark it down, you will face some devious opposition. Look at verse number 10. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. Mark it down. Everybody will not be happy about the fact that you are doing what God has laid on your heart to do. Sadly, the reality is that there are individuals who will conspire and strategize to hinder the work of God. Isn't it sad that even in a local church where you ought to have individuals who are holding hands and uniting hearts for the purpose of building the kingdom, my friend, that there are people in any given church who simply do not want that church to grow. It's mind-boggling, but it is a reality. There will be people who are simply upset that you are trying to build the walls. Sanballat and Tobiah were grieved. Imagine that. And they will be the same ones who are mocking. Look at verse number 19. The Bible says, speaking of these two, that they laughed us to scorn and despised us and said, what is this thing that he do? Will he rebel against the king? Devious opposition. But I love that the fact that even though there was devious opposition, Nehemiah had a determined position. Amen? Look at verse number 20. Then answered I them and said unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Amen. Whether you mock, whether you scorn, it's okay. God will prosper us. And what Nehemiah was saying to them, in other words, if God be for us, who can be against us? There was a determined position. And even when it might seem like you're all alone, God is going to give you some diligent people. Amen. Look at this very important pronoun in verses 17 and 18 and verse number 20. There's a transition because throughout chapter 1 and chapter 2, we see Nehemiah time and time again saying, I, and I took up. I was so afraid. I prayed to the God of heaven. I came to the governors. I arose in the night, verse number 12. Verse number 13, then I went out by night. Verse number 14, then I went on to the gate. Verse number 15, then went I up in the night. But look at verse number 17. He says, then I said unto them, you see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, the gates thereof are burned with fire. Then he said, come and let what? Let us build up the wall. Look at verse number 18. And now they said, let us rise up and build. Verse number 20. He will prosper who? Us. God gave Nehemiah some diligent people to get the job done. Amen. His servants will arise and build. Do you have a burden? Share that with others so that they can get involved in what God has called us to do as a people. There was a decision to build. And notice finally, here's the reason why we ought to arise for success. Because when we arise for success, when we take that burden that God has placed on our hearts because we've discerned the badness and we made a conscious and concerted effort to build, we're going to be able to ultimately to delight in the benefits. You will know that the benefits of responding to a burden that God has placed in one's heart is not rooted in selfishness. It's rooted in thinking about others. It's rooted in the success of the entire body. And here's a very important consideration and question, that when we desire success, the question must be posed, why do we want success? What do we want success for? What is the motive? Is it to be liked? Is it for money? Is it for status? Is it for fame? And here's what I've noticed, that the right motive, the reason why it is so critical to any endeavor for success, is that the right motive keeps you going when things are not going well. The right motive keeps you going when no one has called your name. The right motive keeps you going when you are criticized unfairly. You see, my friend, the harsh reality for us to understand, this thing called rebuilding, it is hard work. And at times, in our humanity, it can feel like very unrewarding work. And I'm simply saying that to say that selfish motives in this thing called rebuilding will be exposed. Selfish motives will invariably run out of steam. But the right motives result in keeping one's hand to the plow. And I want you to notice some wonderful benefits that were evident in this rebuilding effort that the children of Israel and the Jews were able to experience. And my friend, if we are willing, by the grace of God, to keep our hands to the plow and to arise for success, my friend, we will have success. And the success will keep us motivated. Let's observe a number of benefits that were experienced. Turn over to chapter 6 and verse number 1. Notice the benefit of protection. The Bible says, "Now it came to pass when Sambalat and Tobiah and Geshem, the Arabian, and the rest of our enemies heard that I had builded the wall, that there was no breach left therein, though at the time I had not set up the doors upon the gates." Notice what happened. There was no breach. What was the benefit? Protection. Protected. They were now protected from the elements. They were protected from the enemies. And my friend, when we build up the walls of our homes, of our marriages, of our schools, of our communities, my friend, our children and our society will be protected from the elements and from the devastation of sin. Let's repair the breaches. Let's rebuild the walls. Because we will be protected. But notice there's another benefit observed in chapter 8. And it's the benefit of what I call examination. The Bible says in verse number 1 of chapter 8, "And all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate. And they spake unto Ezra the scribe," look at this, "to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding, upon the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate, from the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law." Prior to the walls being broken down, there were so many distractions that they were not paying attention to the word of God. But now that they were protected, now that they were in a safe place, the word of God was made available, and they read it on from morning until midday, and they were attentive. My friend, when we build up the walls, there will not only be the benefit of protection, but there will be the benefit of examination. There's now an opportunity to be attentive, to be focused, to hear what God is saying as he is speaking. Notice another benefit of dedication. As they heard the word, as they were exposed to what thus said the Lord, they responded in obedience to what God said. There was dedication. Verse number 13 of chapter 8. And on the second day were gathered together the chief of all the fathers of all the people, the priests, the Levites, unto Ezra the scribe, and even to understand the words of the law. And they found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month. I mean, they found something out that it seems as though they had forgotten. And look at verse number 16. So the people went forth and brought them and made themselves booths, everyone upon the roof of his house, and in their courts, and in the courts of the house of God, and in the street of the water gate, and in the street of the gate of Ephraim. And all the congregation of them that were come again out of captivity made booths and sat down under the booths. For since the day of Jeshua, the son of Nun, unto the day had not the children of Israel done so. Wow. And there was very great gladness. And also day by day, from the first day until the last, he read in the book of the law of God. And they kept the feast 7 days. And on the eighth day, there was a solemn assembly according unto the manner. Look at the wonderful benefit of the walls having been rebuilt. There were now a people that was determined to dedicate their lives to doing what God wanted them to do. Dedication. I tell you, one of the wonderful benefits and privileges of doing what God has called you to do is seeing people dedicate their lives to the Lord. What a wonderful blessing. And notice the benefit of consecration. Chapter 9 and verse 1. The children of Israel assembled with fasting and sackcloths upon the earth. And the seed of Israel separated themselves from all strangers and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. They consecrated themselves. They set themselves apart for God's use. And then finally, notice the benefit of unification. In chapter 10 and verse 28-29, notice that all the people of all the different backgrounds and nationalities and tribes came together, separated themselves from the people of the lands unto the law of God. And look at verse 29. I love this. They clave to their brethren, their nobles, and entered into a curse and into an oath to walk in God's law. Let the church say amen. Which was given by Moses, a servant of God. And to observe and to do all the commandments of the Lord our Lord, and his judgments and his statutes. These people who had been scattered and separated were now unified. They came together as a nation once again. Why? The walls had been rebuilt. Psalm 133 and verse 1 says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in what? Unity." Unification. And I tell you, you're a child of God. God has touched your heart. These benefits of arising and rebuilding ought to delight you. When we delight in the benefits, when we see the benefits afar off, it gives us the determination to stick with it. Even when there is opposition, when there is difficulty, when there are problems beyond our capacity to solve, recognize the benefits and delight in the benefits. Let's arise for success. And let it be that the success that we are rising for is the result, not just the intention. With God on our side, we can be successful. And I trust that in these difficult days in which we live, with walls having been broken down, that we'll recognize that God has given us what we need to accomplish this rebuilding effort. Let's do it for our families, for our communities, for our churches, for our world. God is able. I implore us, I beg of all of us, let us arise for success.
In light of our conference this week with the theme, Arise and Rebuild, I am here to share a poem, and I pray and trust that it will be a blessing to you and that God be glorified through it. The title of this poem is Opposition and the Work of the Lord. When you put your hands to the work of the Lord, with great indignation, the enemy is wroth. Opposition will arise. God's work he will despise. Great and terrible is our God. He will bring the counsel of the enemy to naught. The enemy's goal is to destroy your soul, to hinder God's work, to have a stronghold. The enemy will do whatever it takes. He invades, he steals. He deceives, he kills. He is committed to opposing God and his people with ridicule and criticism, sarcasm and negativism. He inflicts doubt. He brings about fear. Intimidation and frustration are tools he holds dear. Your ability is criticized, your ambitions scoffed at, your anticipation he taunts, your aspirations mocked at. The enemy belittles your very attempt. He sees evil in your actions. He maligns your good intent. He prowls about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. The enemy will strike at any given hour. Be vigilant, set your guard, put on the full armor of God. For greater is our God who is within us than the God of this world who stands against us. The battle is the Lord's. It belongs not to us. In this, we can be confident. Our God will fight for us. Lift up your voice. Put your prayers before the Lord. Be not dismayed. God hears. He answers prayers. Persevere with all heart in the work of the Lord, knowing that our God has conquered the world. As we go forth, let us arise and rebuild. Let us strengthen our hands for this good work. God bless you all.
Seeking the Lord's, yes, kindly entreat. Wanderers on the mountain astray,
rounding off our list of speakers for this conference 2022 is Pastor Anthony Benjamin. He pastors at the Calvary Baptist Church on St. Croix, and he will speak to us concerning the leader of the work.
It's a delight to be able to greet you tonight in the sweetest name of all, in the name of Jesus. I want to say thanks to Chairman Webster and the conference committee for affording me this opportunity to address you this evening. If my memory serves me correctly, I believe this is the 61st annual West Indies Baptist Fellowship Conference, and that all of it is being carried virtually. I certainly want to say thanks to him and to them for allowing me to address you tonight. The subject matter assigned to me deals with Nehemiah and his leadership style. In fact, the subject matter very specifically says that I have to speak on the leader of the work. Nehemiah chapter 2, the first four verses, will serve as a text for tonight's message, but it will only be a springboard text, in that we will go back and forth in time between chapters 1 and 6, highlighting various styles or various things having to do with Nehemiah leadership style. So with your Bibles open to chapter number 2, glance down at the first four verses, and if you care to, read along with me as I read them tonight. The Bible says, and it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid. And he said unto me, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to the God of heaven. Let us pray. Dear Father, we give you thanks and praises for another West Indies Baptist Fellowship Conference. I pray for all those who will speak or who will have spoken this week, and ask that you would use them to minister to hearts and lives in very special ways. I know that just about everything that will be said surrounds something having to do with Nehemiah. And I pray, Lord God, that you will use him, a familiar name, a familiar story to us, God, to just be refreshing to us and to bless hearts and lives, especially that of those who are chosen by you to lead your respective fellowships here. I pray that you will use it to minister to hearts and lives in the kind of way that only you can. And I ask you tonight that you would help me to do justice to the subject matter assigned to me, that God somehow, somewhere, someone would be blessed as a result of it. Thank you so much for this opportunity. And thanks again for the annual West Indies Baptist Fellowship Conference, the 61st gathering, I believe. I pray for your blessings as they go on, even in the midst of these difficult times. Thanks for what you have done. Thanks for what you are doing now. And thanks, Lord, for what you will continue to do as time goes along. Bless the word, I pray thee, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the story of Nehemiah is both fascinating and frightening. It's the story of a man who overcame great obstacles, a man who took on a Herculean task and succeeded, a man who exhibited fear and trepidation, courage and confidence, godliness and people skills, all in the process of leading the work of God in the rebuilding program having to do with the walls of Jerusalem. My task tonight is to tell you a little about the leader in him and how he was able to do what he did. So by way of introduction, you may have heard it said that a leader is only as good as the people around him, or that a leader is only as good as those persons he selected to lead alongside him as he undertakes whatever task he's undertaking for the greater good of humanity, and certainly for the service of the Lord. You may have heard it said that leadership styles are very many, and that the style the leader employs enables him to succeed and or fail based on the people he is leading. You may have also heard it said that there is no one-size-fits-all approach to leadership. That depending on where you look and who you listen to, there are many different leadership styles around. No one can argue that Paul was not the same type of leader as Peter was, and that Peter was not the same type of leader as Apollos was, and that neither one of them was the same type of leader as Jesus himself was. It is quite possible that's the reason why the church at Corinth had their divisions. They loved one style as opposed to the other and gravitated to the one with the style that they preferred or the style that they loved. And you might remember that Paul took a considerable length to talk about the division in that church based on those persons who were positioned in it as leaders. It tells us a couple of things also, and I'm hoping that I can cover some of those in the short time that I do have. But I know that you are aware that there are at least four major leadership styles embraced by leaders around the world and even within the context of the church. You have heard, I'm sure, of the democratic leader or the so-called the person who leads by majority rule. You have heard of that leader. In fact, the truth is that many churches have been led over many years using that very style. And I want to just jump in here and tell you that it was never God's intent for a church to be a democracy. Hopefully I can address that a little bit later on as we go along. But I want you to notice that there is the democratic leadership style, if you will. Then there is the autocratic leadership style as well. That's the person or the individual who operates as a one-man show. That's a one-man ruler, a person who usurps authority and crushes everyone and everything that does not comply with his particular style of leadership. So there is the democratic leader, there is the autocratic leader, and then there is the oligarchic leader. You may not have heard of this one, but this one is the person who has a small nucleus of people around him, and those people are along with him are who rule the majority. So you have a minority leading the majority of the people, minus the involvement of the people. So whatever they say would go, and so on. So you have the democratic leader, you have the autocratic leader, you have the oligarchic leader, and then you have the theocratic leader. Now all of us would want to be under this type of leadership. This is God rule, if you will, but God rule using human beings in that process. By the way, that's how churches are supposed to operate. Churches are supposed to operate as God-ruled institutions, even though there is an individual whom God may have appointed as the pastor of that church. It is not to be necessarily a democracy, because majority have been wrong. Majority can be wrong. He is not necessarily to be an autocrat, because then he is leading by himself minus God and taking lordship over God's people. He is not supposed to be an oligarchic leader in the sense that he doesn't just gather a few people around him and say, we're going to run things as the case might be. He certainly needs to be a person who operates and who rules under God. And you're going to notice that that's exactly how Nehemiah ruled. That's exactly how Nehemiah led. So, you know, you might be tempted to ask, well, which of these leadership styles best suited Nehemiah? We don't know. Maybe all four of them put together made up who Nehemiah really was as a leader. What I want to show you tonight, though, is that there are several things about him within the first six chapters or so of the book that will set him apart from some others as far as his leadership style is concerned. Among those things, first of all, is his passion. So if you glance back at chapter 1 with me, you will notice that Nehemiah got some disturbing news about the condition of his place and his people. And what he did after that would show us the passion within him, the passion for his people, and the passion for his place. So he was ready to undertake a challenge because he really loved his people and he really loved the place they were from, the place he himself was from as well. So after he got this news, verse 4 tells us, chapter 1 and verse 4, that it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days, and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven, and said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments, let thine ear now be attentive and thine ears open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night, for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, that if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost parts of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now, these are thy servants and thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power and by thy strong hand. O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant, and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name. And prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. You couldn't help but see and feel Nehemiah's passion in those verses. What he heard about his people and his place bothered him so much that they brought out something out of him that forced him to do some things that he didn't really know he was capable of doing. There are a few things that's coming out of his passion that I want you to try to see if you can see them with me, if you will. The first of them is his sensitivity. Clearly, by virtue of what he did in verse 4 and in the first 3 verses of chapter 2, Nehemiah demonstrated that he was sensitive to the cause. He was sensitive to his people. He was not this roughneck, hard-nosed kind of guy that said, you just do what I say, when I say to do it, how I say to do it. He was a man of like passion, just like any other man was, if you will. And you see his sensitivity coming out in a few areas. In chapter 1 and verse 4, the Bible tells us that among the first thing he did was he broke down over the news. Look at it again with me, if you will. And you notice that he said, I sat down and wept. This was a man who had a passion for some things, a passion for his people, a passion for his place. And when he heard the news of the condition of his place, it broke him. He was so sensitive that he broke down and he wept. But he did something else. He not only broke down and wept over it, but verse 4 also tells us that he bemoaned it. What that means is that he considered what was going on there and what was happening to his people as you would deal with someone near to you and dear to you who might have died in the process. He was mourning over them. He was mourning over his place and over his people. The Bible tells us that he mourned certain days. He did something else. He wasn't only broken down over it, he didn't only bemoan it, but notice the Bible tells us that he fasted. The word there means that he blocked his mouth, preventing food from entering into it, meaning that he ate nothing for a while, just seemingly, as it were, staying away from food and crying out to God over his people and over his place. I want to let you know tonight that that kind of passion is never overlooked by God. So he broke down over it, he bemoaned it, he blocked his mouth because of it, and then he did a final thing. The Bible tells us in that same verse that he beseeched God. He said it in verse 11 as well. But he beseeched God, or he prayed before the God of heaven. So he presented the matter to the Lord. First thing we notice that he was a man of passion. But as a man of passion, you notice that he was sensitive. There's a second thing that you will gather from this. Not only was he demonstrating his sensitivity here, but he was also demonstrating demonstrating his spirituality. Look down again at these verses, and you will notice in verse 5, I beseech you. In essence, now then, Nehemiah begins the process of entreating God. He is literally inviting God into their situation. He's telling God a lot of things about himself, a lot of things about his people, but really what he's doing, he's saying, God, we need some help. We need you to step in and do something here. And no indication as of now that he was going to go back and build these walls. No indication as of now that he was going to be the leader who would take on this mammoth task. For now, though, he's simply presenting the matter to God. So out of this passion came sensitivity. Out of this passion also comes spirituality. And in this context of spirituality, he did a few things. Now, he was brokenhearted over the news, so much so that he consecrated himself. He looked at this and he said, God, it is very possible that I am to be blamed for what's going on with my people. Clearly, we are collectively to be blamed for what's going on with us. And so he consecrated himself to God. You see that in verses 5 and 6. The second thing he did after he consecrated himself was he openly confessed. He confessed his sins. He confessed the sins of his people before God, trusting God for his forgiveness and asking God for his help in this process. So he consecrated himself. He confessed his sins. And the third thing you will notice in verses 7 through 10 is that he was concerned. He was concerned about his place. He was concerned about commitment God had, they had made to God and had not kept over time. He was concerned about some things. And so in verse number 7, the Bible tells us, we have dealt very corruptly against thee. He was concerned about how they treated God. He was concerned about God's place among them. He was concerned that the reason they were in the situation they were in was because they had done what God had told them they were not to have done. So he consecrated himself. He confessed his sins. He was concerned for his people and his place. But then in verse 11, he became very contrite. I mean, he was really broken up over the condition. So in verse 11, he says, O Lord, that's chapter 1 and verse 11, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant. And I hope you're noticing that at least three times already in the portions we have read, Nehemiah is praying, or at least he's invoking the word prayer in the process. That's going to be one of the benchmarks of his leadership among these people, if you will. So he continues in verse 11, and he says, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant, and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name, and prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Somebody else, I'm sure, is going to talk about that, or may have already talked about that. But I want just to know, just for you to know this, that he was a man of passion. Out of that passion came sensitivity. Out of that passion, we see spirituality. But then there's another thing that came out of that passion, and that is his sensibility. Nehemiah was a sensible man. Just because he was doing something for God didn't mean that his nose was up in the sky and everything else about him was of no value. He was quite a sensible person. He certainly prayed a lot, but he also used his own common sense a lot as well. And we're going to notice how those things meshed together so as to make him the man he was, so as to make him the leader that he ultimately was. His behavior before the king in verse 11 and then in the first three or four verses of chapter 2 will let you know that he was because you are a Christian, just because you are a pastor, just because you are undertaking a project for God, doesn't mean that you lose your senses in that process. It doesn't mean that you don't use your senses, those that God has given you, so as to help the process along. I know there's some who would want to be so super spiritual that their senses are thrown out the window. I am not one of those, and I pray that you are not one of those, because God gave those to us, and we must use them to carry out His purposes here on earth. So I want you to notice how sensible he was. He clearly would be considered that by the king as well. So you notice the very last statement in verse 11. For I was the king's cupbearer. He is asking God to grant him mercy in the sight of the king. So now he's going to go in before the king. He's going to do his job, but he's going to behave himself just in accordance with the news he received. And when the king saw that, the king couldn't help but step in and do something. So notice in this matter of him being sensible that he unmasked himself. He was a consummate professional. He was the king's cupbearer. But this news caused him to go in before the king bare and open. He recognized that I can't go in here with any pretense. You know how sometimes we do that? We just want people to think that we are who we're not. We want people to think we're strong when we're really breaking down. The point here is that he unmasked himself. He bore his true colors before the king. He wanted the king to see him just as he was. So when you open chapter number 2, the portion we read for our text tonight, you will notice that he is in the king's presence, and the king couldn't help but engage him. The king couldn't help but ask him some questions as to why he was looking the way he was looking, as to why he was behaving the way he was behaving. Nehemiah didn't go back to his quarters and say, let me wash my face, let me fix myself up, let me go into the king and pretend that nothing is going on, let me just be the strong person. He didn't do that, did he? No, he unmasked himself. He wanted the king to see that he was a person who was very passionate about his people and his place, and the news he got bothered him so much that he couldn't help but just bear it all before the king. Incredible passage, if you will. But not only did he unmask himself, but Nehemiah was unsure of what he really wanted. Say, again, just to let you know, he was an ordinary man. No one man knows everything about anything. Nehemiah didn't really know what he wanted. He was just an ordinary fellow. And when the king asked him, what is it that he wanted? Nehemiah didn't know what to say. He was unsure of himself. He was unsure as to what he wanted. Sometimes it's good to be that way. Sometimes it's good to be yourself. You don't need to pretend that you have all the answers. You don't need to pretend that you always know what to do. Sometimes it's good to acknowledge that I don't know. I'm just not sure as to how to do this and how to do that. It is then that God steps in and does some things that amazes even the best of us. So look down at verse 4, chapter 2. Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? What did Nehemiah do? So I prayed to the God of heaven. He didn't know what he wanted. He didn't even know what he was going to do. All he could do was pray. This is incredible. And sometimes we undertake challenges, or God places some things on us, and we really don't know how to do them. We really don't know. And it's good to acknowledge that, God, I don't know King, I don't know. I'm going to have to pray over this. Let me pray over this and see what God says. Let me pray over this and see where God leads. See, that was Nehemiah. The point is that he was quite sensible. He went in en masse. He was altogether unsure. And in verses 5 to 11 of chapter number 2, he was unreserved about his request. Now, he went back, he prayed, he sought the Lord, and then he came back to the king, and he's making his request to the king. What exactly did he request? Well, the first instance, the first thing he did was that he requested leave. If you look down at verse number 6 of chapter number 2, the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by me, or by him, for how long shall thy journey be? And when wilt thou return? So it pleased the king to send me as I set him a time. Again, his sensibility comes in here. We don't know what time was set, but we know that he told the king, I want to go back to Judah, that's verse number 5. I want to go back to my hometown, and I want to build my father's sepulchres. I want to build back up my place. So his request was, I want you to give me some leave time. He is requesting leave. But that was not his only request. He requested leave to go back, yes. But he also requested letters. He said, I want you to give me some letters so that when I get to the other side of the river, things would be in order. This is a thorough man. This is a man who is setting up all the things in place so that when he did go back, he would be able to do what he had to do without any real challenge. Moreover, verse 7, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me to the governors beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come into Judah, and a letter unto Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams of the gates of the palace, which appertain to the house, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me according to the good hand of God upon me. Incredible passage, incredible situation. So on the one hand, he is requesting leave. On the other hand, he's requesting letters, and yet another hand, he is requesting legitimacy. I want to go and do this, but I want to do this legally. I don't want to have any problems when I get across there. So I want you to give me all the permits I need so that when I go there and start to undertake this challenge, nobody is trying to shut me down. This is the leadership within the man. He is really stepping up and he's really saying, I want to go and do this, but I want to go and do this unhindered. Then I came to the governors beyond the river, verse number 9, and gave them the king's letters and so on and so forth. And you can go on down and see, but no sooner than the letters were granted, notice the Bible tells us in verse 10 that when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. Incredible. You know, it was just good for them if the place laid waste. The minute someone came and started to work on it, all of a sudden, it was a problem for them. The first thing we noted from him, though, from Nehemiah, and his particular style of leadership, was that he was quite passionate about what he did, quite passionate about his people, quite passionate about his plans. There's a second thing I want you to notice from the passage, and you'll find this in chapters 2 and 3. Along with his passion, notice his preparation. As any good leader, he would count the cost before he undertook the task. So before a plan was drawn, before a person was contacted, to lay that out before us tonight in the little time I have, so as to just let us know that, listen, when God assigns us something, there's some legwork that we must do. We must do some things. There's some things God expects us to do. There's some things God's not going to do for us. He gave us the task. He calls us to lead. But he expects us to do some things in that process that we must do for ourselves. And Nehemiah understood that. He understood that if he was going to lead these people, he needed to be in a place where he could do that by himself. And so the first thing he did in the preparation process was that he surveyed the area. I can't let this pass us by, if you will. So glance down at verse 12 of chapter number 2. The Bible tells us, "And I arose in the night, I and some few men with me." Watch this. "Neither told I any man what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me, save the beast that I rode upon. And I went by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port, and viewed the walls of Jerusalem which were broken down, and the gates thereof were consumed with fire. Then I went on to the gate of the fountain and to the king's pool, but there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. Then I went up in the night by the brook and viewed the wall and turned back and entered by the gate of the valley, and so returned. And the rulers knew not." See this? "The rulers knew not whither I went or what I did. Neither had I as yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work." He is surveying the area. He is looking at the work to be done. He is doing so incognito. He's doing so while others are sleeping. He's doing it in the night. He understood that the task was great. And so while others slept, he got up and he surveyed. He looked at the task to be done and wanted to make sure that he had a good understanding of what was involved. It is incredible here what he's doing. So the first thing he did in the preparation stage is that he surveyed the area. The second thing he did in the preparation stage, after he surveyed the area, he then shared the vision. See, now he saw what was to be done. He had done the legwork himself. He went and looked at the place himself. And now that he saw what it was, he called the fellow leaders together and he said, "All right, guys, this is where I'm at. This is what's going on. This is how." He wasn't trying to do it himself. That's something that we have to try to, avoid as much as possible as leaders. So he wouldn't try to do it himself. He surveyed it himself so that he could share with those who would help him to do it what he saw and what he was about to do. So when you look down at verse number 17, "Then said I unto them." See, now he's sharing the vision. "Ye see the distress that we're in, and how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, and that we be no more a reproach. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me." So all this went on. All this, back and forth with the king, all these letters, all the things that Nehemiah never saw knew. It was just a matter between him and God. And in that process, God would allow for the circumstances to come together well. So he surveyed the area, the first thing he did. The second thing he did was he shared the vision. The third thing he did was he solicited help. All of chapter 3 is about those persons whom Nehemiah assigned to various tasks. All of chapter 3 had to do with those men who were going to help with the project. He was not going to do this by himself. Was he among them? Yes. Did he have a tool in one hand and a sword in another? Yes. But he was not going to do it himself, nor was he going to tell people to do it and just stand off and watch them. He was going to be a part of the project. And he certainly wanted to lead by example. Guys, do what I do. Not merely what I say. You do what I do. And when he did that, everybody, I mean, it was incredible. You could read the book for yourself. But when he did that, it was incredible how these people got up and decided, we're going to do that. That's where the concept of a mind to work, a heart to pray, an eye to watch, and all those things came from, because they knew now that they were a part of this project. Let me share something with you tonight that you already know, and that is this. People will always support what they help to create. You can't leave people out of the equation, and when you get into some trouble, you run to them. That's not how this works. You involve them in the process. You're with them in the process. When trouble comes, guess what? They're right there with you. They're not going anywhere. That's just how this is. So there are two things we've noted so far, right? We've noted his passion. We've noted his preparation. One last thing in the passage, and we're done for tonight, and that is perseverance. Now, this is going to take up chapters 4 and some of 5 and some of 6. We're not going to look at all of those. We're just going to highlight a few quick things as we go to show you the type of person, the type of leader this man was. First of all, I want to let you know that any great undertaking, whether it's an undertaking for God or an undertaking in any other setting, any great undertaking is going to have some challenges. It's just not going to go as easily as you would like for it to go. Any great undertaking will have some challenges. When the challenges come, your leadership style is going to either support you or defeat you. Now, someone has said it another way, that when the testing time comes, a man reveals who he is by what he does. What did Nehemiah do? First thing he did was he prayed. And I know I've hinted at this already, but it's worth looking at again. For when you open up chapter number 4, he is praying again. You saw him praying in chapter 1. You saw him praying in chapter number 2. You open up chapter number 4, and he is praying again. Here he says, O God, look at verse 4. Hear, O our God, for we are despised, and turn in their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. And cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. And he's referencing here Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabians, the Ashdodites, the group of people that came up against Nehemiah and his men as they built. The first thing he did was he prayed. The last thing he did was he prayed as well. So in verses 1 to 6, you notice chapter 4, how he prayed. Now, you're going to notice, beginning from chapter 1 on down to chapter number 6, that he's praying all the time. So he prayed initially. When he first got the news, he prayed. He prayed intermediately. After he went to the king, he prayed. I have to pray and see what God wants me to do in this process. He prayed intentionally. You see that in chapter 4 and verse 4, as Sanballat and Tobiah, the Arabians, the Ashdodites, and all these people came up against him. He prayed again. And then in chapter 4 and verse 9, he's praying yet again. This time he's praying incessantly. The point is that the reason he persevered, the reason he was able to do this, the reason God used him in this way was because he prayed often. But he did something else. He not only prayed often, he paid close attention. He observed what was going on. And if you read chapter 4, verses 7 to 23, you couldn't help but see that he was paying close attention to the opposition, namely Sanballat, Tobiah, and the group, who were trying their utmost to stop him from doing what God had sent him to do. He paid close attention to them, so much so, in fact, that they held a sword in one hand, a tool in another hand, and if they made a wrong move, they were going to have some things to deal with. Some things are worth fighting for. There's some things you just don't surrender. There's some things you stand up and you fight for, especially when you know that God is holding you accountable for this particular thing. So there, he certainly paid attention to the opposition, verses 7 to 12 of chapter 4. He paid attention to the operation. I mean, he strategically placed these people along the walls, at various gates along the walls, so that these people could build up their own area of the wall, while at the same time keeping a close eye on those persons who are trying to stop them. So he prayed. He certainly paid attention. He paid attention to the opposition. He paid attention to the operation. And then he paid attention to the objective. We're here to build this wall. We're not going to let anything stop us. You are never, ever greater than the thing it takes to stop you. So God has given you a task to do. And he's placed this task in your lap. You do it. You do it with everything you have until it is done. So in this perseverance, he prayed, he paid attention, and then he did something else. He persisted against all odds. So 52 days after they started, as chapter 6 will highlight, 52 days after they started, the wall was completed. And it was completed because they insisted on staying focused. Listen, there are so many distractions around. Even within the context of the leadership, within the context of the people you're leading, there is distraction. And you know, there was a time when one within them, some guy named Gashmu, came up with an idea that some things were being said and some things were being done. And Nehemiah said, we don't have time for that. This is time to build. This is time to work on what God has given us. They send him letters saying, let's meet in the valley of Ono. Nehemiah said, we're not going to do that. We're not going to do that because God has given us a task. And so he was able to do this because he insisted on staying focused. He ignored ungodly counsel. You know, everybody always wants to tell you something when you're leading. Everybody wants to give you an idea. Everybody wants you to do this. Everybody wants you to do that. You, as the leader under God, must listen to God. And God will let you know what? This advice is not right. This advice is not wise. So, dismiss that. Don't follow that. And you notice in verses 5 through 9 of chapter number 6, that some ungodly counsel came to him, and he wasn't by any means willing to go with that. So he persisted because he insisted on staying focused. He persisted because he ignored ungodly counsel. He persisted because of his intuition and discernment. God gave him the ability to discern some things. So he knew before it happened that some things were going to happen in the process. And then he was able to persist and complete this project because he inspired others along the way. Listen, God has placed different ones of us in leading roles. God expects us under him to complete the task that he's given us. So I want to close tonight by giving you a few pointers that I term as the marks of a godly leader. Now, to understand that, I want you to turn to 2 Samuel chapter 23. 2 Samuel chapter 23, as you know, are the closing words of David. He's preparing to bid farewell, and so he added some words that he wanted to share with those who he was leaving behind. I want you to hear this. Chapter 23, 2 Samuel, verse 1. Now these be the last words of David. David, the son of Jesse, said, "And the man who was raised up on high, the anointed of the God of Jacob, and the sweet psalmist of Israel, said, the Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue. The God of Israel said, the Rock of Israel spake to me, he that ruleth," watch this, "he that ruleth over men must be just, ruling in the fear of God. And he shall be as the light of the morning when the sun riseth, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass springing out of the earth by clear shining after rain. Although my house be not so with God, yet he hath made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things, and sure, for this is all my salvation and all my desire, although he maketh it not to grow." In those verses, David leaves with us what I term the marks of a godly leader. The first mark of this leader is that he rules. That is to say, he leads. The ruling here is not dictatorial. The ruling here really is about the matter of leading. And I have to say something as I close, you know. I have to say something else, rather. That is this. Leadership has very little to do with position. You know that you are a leader if and when people are following you. If you have to tie a rope around their necks and drag them along, you're not leading, and that's not the kind of leader that God uses. You must understand that leading or leadership has very little to do with position. Wherever one is able to lead if that's who that person is. So the first thing he tells you, the first mark he gives you, is that you must be able to rule. The second is you must be righteous. He who rules over men must be just. He must be righteous. He must be following God and leading under God. That's why I said earlier, this is theocratic leadership, not a democracy, not an autocracy, not an oligarchy, but as it were, a theocracy. He leads under God. He's also respectful. You look down at verse number 3, at the ending of that verse, he's ruling in the fear and the reverence and respect of God. He's not just treating people any old how he wants to treat people. He's understanding that these are God's people, and he's being such a good respect unto them in the process. In verse 4, a fourth mark would be that of a person who is refreshing. David expressed it this way. He said that he shall be as the light of the morning. Imagine that, the leader. As the light of the morning when the sun rises, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass springing out of the earth by clear shining after the rain. He is refreshing. He's the kind of person that you don't have any issue coming to and speaking with and presenting your case to, and knowing that this person is going to refresh your spirit. He's not going to beat you over the head. Although sometimes as a leader you have to do some of that, he is going to make sure that you are refreshed in the process. And then the last thing here, you follow him, right? He rules, he's righteous, he's respectful, he's refreshing, and then he's responsive. Notice, David said in verse number 5, I was not that kind of leader. Notice how he put it. He said, although my house be not so with God, I'm not like the person I'm describing in these verses. But even though I'm not like that person, God hath made me with me an everlasting covenant. And God is going to do ultimately what God is going to do. So he says, I'm responding to God. The person now who is leading in this context, as was Nehemiah, was a person, must be a person who rules and rules well under God. He must be righteous, which means that he is in a relationship with God. He must be respectful, which means he treats others with dignity and respect in the process. He must be refreshing, which means, if you will, that he is a breath of fresh air to those who are having issues and so on. And then he must be responsive. My prayer tonight is that you can be that kind of leader. My prayer tonight is that you can be a modern day Nehemiah. My prayer tonight is that God has used his word to bless your heart in whatever way. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you so much for your precious word. And thank you for men like Nehemiah who dared to stand up and remain standing until the purpose for which you called them was completed. There's more to his life. And I'm sure through the course of the week, more will have been heard. But I just want to thank you for using him to minister to me personally, and I hope to us collectively as pastors and lay leaders and so on, how we must lead. Thank you so much for using the word tonight. And bless all those who will utter it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And amen. Amen.